Hey guys, is this on? Yes. How's everybody doing tonight? Good. That's how I feel too. I'm so excited to get into this conversation with the cast and creator of Mr. Robot. Just a heads up, we have some of your fantastic questions collected already up here, so we'll be getting to those later in the evening. But before I take up any more of your time, let's bring out the cast. Okay, joining us from the cast of Mr. Robot, we have Carly Chaikin, Portia Doubleday, Grace Gummer, Stephanie Corneliussen, Rami Malek, Christian Slater, and creator and executive producer Sam Esmail. Hey guys.
Hi, Andy.
How's everybody doing?
Great.
Doing all
just
right.
Great.
Am I correct? I think I am correct in saying this is the first time you guys have all been together since ending work on season two and promotional duties.
I think so, yeah.
That's true. Yeah.
Well, of us.
The Emmys.
Yeah, all of us together.
Oh, yeah, the Emmys.
That's right. Yeah, that was okay. A good night.
What's it like to get back together again? Is it exciting to see each other again, or is there a kind of Sunday I haven't done my homework yet and school's about to start feeling?
It's just like, ugh, I hate everyone. I'm just kidding. It's funny because when you're working, you all these
well,
people
they just interrogate
your family.
Me. That's all they do between seasons.
They we what?
Badger? Interrogate me? Yeah.
Yeah, that just happened.
That just happened in the green room.
Well, okay, so let's just go there before we even get into
everybody
it. How
just
much cast? This is an actor's event, so I think we need to focus on the cast. So, unlike every other,
I'll shut up.
Unlike every other time we've done one of these, feel free to talk over Sam. I give you permission. What do you guys know about season three? And is Sam correct?
Nothing, Portia.
Why did you just tell her?
Okay, I'm not gonna say it. I'll probably end up saying something.
No.
I just found out we go to like a commune in West Virginia.
Oh, nice. Good. Sam, are you prepared to deny everything tonight and always?
No, I can't do that either. I gotta.
There's nothing to deny. We don't know anything.
There you go.
Right,
good answer.
Since this is the first time you guys have all been together since a certain night, I think the most important question to ask, obviously, to the cast as a whole is how much has Rami changed since winning an Emmy, and how unbearable is he now?
They can't look me in the eye on set anymore.
Are they just learning that now, or did they know that?
Oh,
is that okay? It has to be okay.
You take this one, Rami. You go
rules.
Ahead.
What an asshole.
All right.
We haven't seen each other, honestly, in quite a...
Well,
we just
like
talked
a really
about
long
that.
Time. Really long time.
Forever. I know. Yeah. It's been a while.
But you actually do like spending time with each other, which I think is worth noting.
Can't
I feel
wait.
Like, I don't know if that's always the case with ensembles.
Can't wait to get back. Can't wait.
Yeah.
Right? When do we get back? You can answer that, right?
I think I
we're
can.
Not allowed to talk about it.
Are we allowed to?
I think we should
to,
talk
like,
about
like,
it.
Say
let's talk
when?
About it.
No.
No, we're I'm not allowed
again.
To say.
So what are we even doing here?
Person.
This is madness.
All right, well, before we let chaos take over and we ask you questions you won't answer about season three, let's talk about why we're here. Let's talk about season two of Mr. Robot.
All right.
For me, one of the real pleasures of season two was seeing all of the members of the ensemble really get a chance to add layers to their to your characters, to the performances you established in season one. Characters were placed in different places. Obviously, there were different stakes involved. Portia, let's start with you, because I feel like, I know I've said this before, but I feel like no character changed more from one season to another than Angela. You went from what other people have described as a, you know, the nice girl at the next cubicle to basically a corporate assassin. Not literally, although that might be a season three spoiler. At what point were you aware of the changes the character was about to face, and how did it change your preparation?
Well, Sam, I guess now it's become this tradition of he calls and we're silent for about 45 minutes to an hour because he tells us absolutely everything. Yeah. And so I scribble like at a crazy pace and I can't ask any questions really until it's over. So I knew everything from the start, and it kind of felt appropriate from where we had left off, and I So I'd already been thinking about that. I think physically there was also a change. I think there was a different confidence about her. I think that she actually fit in a lot more than she had expected to. And you know, I always reference, like, after everything she had been through in the first season, you know, watching someone commit suicide on national television and the turmoil that she's constantly kind of taking in without expressing, what effect that has on a person. And so anyway, in the second season, I felt like there was just this kind of tempered internal struggle and, that fine line that was actually really fun playing in the second season. Does that answer your question? I feel like that was fairly long-winded.
That's what I was going for, so thank you.
Okay, great.
No, I think you answered my question, and you in fact inspired another, which is...
I probably answered like three people's...
Yeah, we're almost done up here, I think. No, Sam, is that definitely your strategy to inundate them with information so that they can't ask you more questions than you want them to?
100%, yeah, yeah. No, I honestly, these guys are so brilliant, and I don't ever pretend to know all the answers. And these are my co-creators. You know, these characters are not born on the page. They're born when they go out there and perform it. And I do this so that I can hear their feedback. I do this so I can hear their feedback and, you know, and bring it in, because they're going to make it alive. They have to feel that it's authentic and it's true to them, and without that connection to it, it doesn't work. So they're part of the process, as far as I'm concerned.
Rami, so do you think he does it so he can hear the feedback and adjust to the feedback, or so he can hear the feedback to better defend himself from it in the future?
It is a moment where, you know, he'll start nodding and you wonder if the nods are just like, go away and let me do my thing, or, huh, that's interesting, I might incorporate that perspective, or, I have no idea, thank you very much for writing the story for me, right? No. He always has a... The thing about Sam from the beginning is, you know, he's told us this. He said one thing very early on, and I think it was a conversation he had with Ryan Murphy, was about casting, and it was very important to cast the right people. It'll get so much of the work done. And I think Sam did, obviously, a phenomenal job with this group. And I don't think you were saying it is unusual that people get along, I think, this well. And I think that's a tribute to the choices that he made from the beginning and throughout. Every time I see a scene on this show, I'm constantly blown away, and oftentimes thinking, oh, I want to work with that actor now, and that actor, I wish I had more scenes. And we're all that way. It's like, why aren't we working together in a scene? So I've segued from the original thing, but he's been so great about allowing us to really take these characters on, and you know, we offer up our thoughts, not advice necessary, our thoughts. And with Sam, you really have to lawyer up and come with, you know, cold hard facts as to why you would do certain things. Otherwise, he'll just
I'm the corporate assassin.
You're the corporate assassin. You really have to know what you're talking about before you decide to make any changes. It's not an on the day, let me throw this in. And he'll be like, where did that come from and why? No, stick to the page.
Well, we may prove that not to be the case when we show a blooper reel later, but we'll come back to that. Stephanie, I wanted to bring you into it as well, because I gave Angela all the credit for changing the most, but I think Joanna found herself in a very different circumstance in season two as well. After playing most of your scenes in season one with Tyrell, your husband, your character's husband, he was not around very much in season two, and you had a very, very different role to play. How did those changes affect your understanding of the character?
On a professional level, I got to work much more with Jeremy Holm, which was fantastic. He's an amazing actor. But I miss Martin a lot. And then when we saw each other, there was a couple of flashback scenes or dream sequences. And when we saw each other, it was actually a very emotionally loaded moment. I got a little misty-eyed there. But, you know, Joanna has
I don't know if she's changed. I think we've just gotten to know her a little better. I think after season one and that infamous lobster fork scene, everybody knows what I'm talking about. I think the question was, you know, where is she willing to go? And I think after the scene in season two with Jeremy acting as her henchman, Sutherland acting as her henchman, we saw exactly where she's willing to go. So I think we just got a very, very clear perspective of who we're dealing with. Joanna is ruthless in some senses. We use the Macbeth.
She's the boss.
Reference. She's the boss. We use the Macbeth reference a lot, but I've started to looking into seeing her more of like a Catherine the Great, like the Empress of Russia in the 17th. Am I wrong? 16th, 17th century?
Definitely right.
Yeah, right, right.
I didn't go to college.
Oh, those educated liberals, how we hate them.
We've heard a number of people say already that this ensemble is wonderfully close. Grace, what was that like for you as a new member of the cast to join an already humming machine, basically, in season two?
Well, I
tortured her.
Yeah, they hazed me. No, I felt so welcome with open arms. I mean, it was as if I had been there. And they were also so keen on telling me how important my role was and my side to the story was for the advancement of the show. So, yeah, we got along great.
Do you remember when we met at the table read and we stood over coffee?
We said that we should be lovers.
We said that we should be lovers. That was first.
That was true.
And then I remember just hardcore fangirling over you, like, oh my God, I love you so much. And then she said, oh my God, I love you too. And my heart fluttered. Just for a moment, but it did flutter.
That's a beautiful story. I think we should just pause for a moment. Sam, how much of a goal was it for you moving from a successful season one into season two to really let the ensemble shine as an ensemble?
Well, I mean, I think it was everything. I mean, you know, a TV show is only as great as its characters. I don't really give a shit about plot. Plot's like, I mean, we've seen all the plot machinations that we're probably ever going to see. Who cares? It's about the characters, how they make those choices, how interesting they are, what their worldview is like. That to me is the thing that's really fascinating. And the first season was kind of, in my opinion, a little burdened by the fact that we have to initiate this hack and the evil, you know, like take down Evil Corp, etc. Second season let us breathe a little bit and let us kind of widen. Wait, how do you call what you say? You articulate it, so what? Widen the base? Is that what
thank
you?
Thank you.
You
expand the frame.
Deepen wide, deepen and widen the.
Oh, that's what she said.
So this is why.
She says it so well.
No, you can't follow that. Anyway, this is the fun part. The fun part is getting to like explore these characters, and they're all so different. And you know, the one thing I got to compliment these guys on. That, you know, most shows, I think, especially with a cast this big, there's a lot of relationship drama that they have to sort of explore, and that's sort of how you learn about their characters. They're breaking up with somebody, they're falling in love with somebody, they're marrying somebody, etc. These guys are basically always alone, and they're always exploring what it looks like for them to be lonely. I mean, you said it yourself. You know, Stephanie's character Joanna was not without her, without her husband the entire season. You know, Portia was sort of off in this like corporate sea of suits, and Carly, even though she, Darlene, even though she had her new faction of F-Society, she was locking herself in the bathroom and having panic attacks. And obviously, Elliot was in this sort of self exile. So, I for me, it was like it's more that. Is much harder, I think. You cannot play off of anybody else's energy. And these guys had to really kind of, dive deep into their own character's psyche and explore what it means to actually have scenes where they're just by themselves.
I'm a little disturbed that you seem to have hacked into my questions, because that actually was what I wanted to talk to you guys about, that one of the hallmarks of the show is that each of the characters has to is given these opportunities to have very wrenching emotional scenes with no one to play off of.
Well, I had Alexa to play off.
I was going to get to that. So you had a robot pal.
Yes, I did.
How great was she in that scene?
Alexa?
Guys, I gotta be honest with you guys. So, like, now I'm asking this amazing actress to literally, I mean, like, the thing was working, right? Like,
It was the script supervisor.
Oh, yeah, that's right. So she's talking to a script supervisor, looking at this, like, cylinder thing, and how brilliant was she? I mean, that's just incredibly difficult. I didn't even know how to direct you in that. I was just like, wow.
I agree, I'm amazed. I wanted to ask you all as actors how you approach scenes like that, how you, you know, get yourself prepared, how you know that you're delivering when you don't have that that scene partner to help guide you through it.
Well, I will say too, just because, you know, you guys are all actors also, so I think one of the coolest things that I've learned about a lot of the stuff we do is a lot of the times we're acting to nothing, where like the last scene of mine when I'm like looking at the whole board when we were actually shooting it, I was looking at a blank thing with pieces of tape around it.
Like a camera operator.
Right.
Yeah.
So a lot of the times we really don't even have like props or anything to do it. But I think with, you know, having Sam is like one of the best, the most helpful thing ever, because I'll be having a hard time going somewhere or doing something and we just talk about it and just have that a straight conversation about what's really going on in a true and honest way, that it just naturally gets you to that place of what they're feeling. And I think one of the coolest things for me about doing a TV show is you get to play the same character, you know, over multiple seasons, and so you really get to learn and grow with them. And, you know, in the same way that the audience is getting to know the characters, we are too. So coming back season two, I feel like, you know, as much as we all changed, we had such a better grasp of who we are and history to who we are, and really like a foundation of like a jumping off point into like this new world.
Which kind of also takes us full circle to the whole fact that Sam gives us so much creative freedom. It's almost like I want to call it a creative playground for all of us. It is pretty amazing.
Go ahead.
We're also lucky of being in such a safe space. You know, like as an actor, you need to feel safe to fail and to look like an idiot and to fuck up and to be like, that was horrible, and feel like comfortable doing that and falling on your face. Yeah. And I think, you know, just with all of us being as close as we are and how amazing the crew is and Sam is, it really gives us a space to play and to take risks and try things.
Rami, you obviously have to play a lot of scenes solo, but when you are not solo, you have this wonderful scene partner who just won't leave you alone. And I feel like we should take a look at a clip just to remind everyone about this just touching father-son drama that plays out in the background of an otherwise hacking-centric show. So let's take a look at this clip.
So touching.
It seemed very sweet. It's like a Hallmark card brought to life.
Touching like a Hallmark card.
Yeah, Hallmark card.
Christian, obviously the nature of the Mr. Robot character changed a lot in the course of season two, leading to this strange sort of complete disassociation glitching that we saw later in the season that we just watched now. Mm-hmm. But one of the hallmarks of the first part of the season was that your character appeared a lot more antagonistic than he had previously, and I base that solely on the evidence of your character shooting your son's character in the head point blank.
That was a good sign.
In the season
yes.
premiere. I mean, yes. I feel like I'm not overreaching then.
No.
Touching on the antagonism.
Yeah.
But that said, you were also given the chance to play a more tender side in a flashback.
Uh-huh.
Do you have a preference of which version of the character to play?
Wow.
That's a great question.
Yeah. Thanks, Ron.
Really good. Christian?
Because I'm very intrigued. I think I know the answer.
You do?
I think so.
Yeah.
Say it together on three.
One, two, three.
Tender.
That's wonderful.
That was a really tender moment.
That was great TV, you guys. That was great panel.
No, it's true.
But, quick follow-up. Tell us why.
Well, yeah.
I was always in some type of anguish doing those moments, like pushing me off of the boardwalk or the gun to the head.
Agony.
You can see, I mean, as soon as the camera's rolling, he'll step into it. Beforehand, he's looking at the gun and looking at me like, oh, I really don't want
to
do
I really
do
have
this,
to do this.
In a matter of minutes, I'm going to have to blow your brains out. That's right. So I'm just going to accept this, but I really don't like it. And he'll tell me, like, this is... This is something I'm not looking forward to.
He's hitting you, but he's hugging you at the same time. Mm-hmm. He's hitting you, but he's hugging you at the same time.
Right.
He won't. But
that's right.
Christian, is it a challenge to keep both halves of the character present in every scene, considering you are the character's father and a delusion and someone shooting him in the head? It's a tall order.
Wow. I mean, yeah. How can I even answer it? I think the thing that made it all possible or makes it all possible is the preparation of Sam Esmail, really. That's what I've said all along. I mean, the fact that we came in after season one and he handed us that phone book size script and we had, you know, we sat around a table and got the opportunity to read through everything together. That put us all on the same page. We all kind of knew what our whole journey was going to be and what the direction of the season was. And that, I think, just certainly made me feel very safe and very comfortable, very excited. I loved having all that information. That was amazing. So there was just that, I think, like somebody else was saying, I mean, it just gave us the opportunity to relax into it and feel very safe and comfortable. So that makes, I think, all of our characters that much more realized.
Sam, now that season two has aired and we cannot spoil it, can you talk a little bit about the conversation you had with Christian about how his character would continue to exist in this world, how you might deepen and complicate it in the ways that you did?
Well, I mean, you know, the thing is, and this goes for every season of the show, is that we're telling different chapters of one story. So, and the central sort of conflict for the whole series is this relationship between Elliot and Mr. Robot. And I remember telling Christian all of this in the first season. I was like, you know, the show's, you know, it's really about this kind of split dissociative incident that happens with Elliot. And how is he going to sort of reconcile or negotiate?
And you told them right away.
Right away. Okay. Then I think around episode 9 of the first season, when we did the graveyard scene and it came out that, you know, all right, Mr. Robot's not real. Whoa. Do you need to get that?
That was literally a spoiler alert for what you just said.
Tinder.
Tinder. Yeah. So then Christian came up to me and he's like, "So am I in the second season?" And I'm like, "Yes, we went over this already."
Of actor panic, like, you know,
right.
I really like this character, man.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, I hadn't read episode 10 yet.
Right.
I didn't know what was gonna happen.
Right. I'm like, the show is called You. and so every season, and this is the thing that Christian has to do, right? Every season is a different stage of this disorder. And every season, that character, the Mr. Robot character, has to sort of reflect at what stage Elliot is sort of handling this disorder. And obviously the second season was about the fight.
I was pissed.
The battle.
Yeah.
Elliot, in no circumstances, wanted to have him in his existence anymore. And so that, of course, just made Mr. Robot this fucking asshole.
Period.
And you know, I gotta say, the thing is, we never played delusion. Because who gives a shit? What is that? That doesn't mean anything. Christian plays a human, and he plays it with a really relatable emotion, and like the fight for existence, the fight for survival, is basically sort of...
I want to live just as much as Elliot
exactly.
does.
And he plays that as a person. And when we do the flashbacks, one of my favorite scenes this season, you and the kid, young Elliot, at the end of episode 5, I mean, Christian turns it on like that, and he's now not the Mr. Robot we're used to seeing, but the actual father, the Edward Alderson character. And the fact that they're the same, the fact that Christian can pull that off, even though they're totally different in behavior and attitude, but it's the same person, and you're seeing two shades of it, it's just remarkable. And I have to give him credit too, because I also, you know, directing, you know, kid actors, child actors, or sometimes I wasn't in the car with him. I mean, I was on the little radio or whatever. I mean, this guy did the bulk of the work. So he really, I mean, in that scene, he's just a beautiful performance. Beautiful performance.
Carly, I want to circle back to something you were saying before that I think is really interesting and also true, that one of the benefits of TV is the opportunity to spend more time within a character, to deepen it, and the audience's relationship deepens as well. Given that, in season two, Darlene suffered a lot of losses, beginning from the very beginning of the season all the way up to the end when she loses her boyfriend on top of everything else. As an actor who's spent this time building up a person, how do you keep track of these layers of loss? Basically, if you have to you're this upset, and then you're this upset. These are acting terms, by the way. This upset, little bit upset. And then how do you track that emotional development?
Andy,
thank you.
FYI.
Appreciate that. And then is it even more complicated to track that development considering you are block shooting the season?
Right. Yeah, I mean, we were all over the place because one part of the day I'm like this upset, one part I'm like this upset, and then this upset. And so I definitely was like, Sam, what is going on here?
I would go.
Yeah, you're this go today. Here.
Do you know those pain charts at hospitals where it's the smiley face and the frowny face? Just...
Can I tell you something though, for real?
Yeah.
Next season, mark my words, I'm gonna be like, Sam, is it here? Here. Fully. It's gonna be our new thing.
It's all part of the process, guys. You're welcome.
Yeah. I think just, you know, when you know, one, I think, you know, she's kind of, her natural state of being is this upset. And, you know, I just think, like, when you really understand, like, what's going on and where you're at and what your story is, it's a lot easier to stay in that. I'm not even making sense. I don't know what the fuck I'm saying. It was a really fun challenge, though, to be able to go...
Just quit smoking 2 weeks ago, so give it up! Come on! Yeah, I mean, sorry. Is that okay to say?
Yeah.
Right?
Okay.
That's a big deal.
This, like, as a human being, like, on your emotion, whatever's happened to you as a human being, you can go back and track it. I guess through therapy, you track things and you go back in, right?
I do.
How many years has that been now?
All together or solo?
But you start looking at the things that have happened in your life, and there are moments you do that when you least expect them. Like you'll go back and you know, in a session of therapy or whatever it is for you, where you account for all those things. But I suppose in the moment of having things happen, you really don't account for everything that's previous. It's all an accumulation, and sometimes it manifests itself in different ways. So that's what's interesting about watching a character that you know from an outside perspective as an audience member. You're watching and you're tracking everything that's happening. But watching someone go through that.
Living it in the moment.
In the moment, yeah. Where they really can't account for everything that's happened to them in
they
the
can't
last
see
week,
it.
2 weeks. Or,
right.
You can't do that in the moment. And that's what I think is inevitably... You know, those really profound, magical moments on screen when someone, you know, does something that you wouldn't expect knowing their history.
I also think a lot of the stuff you end up, like, discovering as you're doing it, where there have been, you know, there was a scene when I was, telling, you know, the rest of my crew that Susan Jacobs was dead. I never expected that scene in that moment to turn into what it was. You know, I didn't think about it that much. It was just kind of became that. And then when we were doing it, that was honestly one of the darkest places I went to all season, was having that moment of like total detachment from, you know, myself into that. And I remember that was the hardest day of block shooting, because after I did that scene and we had to go back to being frantic, I was like, I can't do this, because I was in such a crazy, dark, detached, sociopathic place. But I think that's what's fun about acting is not, you know, you get to the moment and sometimes don't know what's going to come out.
Can I just talk about that scene for a second? So the scene where Darlene kills Susan Jacobs, the thing that Carly does so brilliantly, because there's this is and this is like the layers part, right? It's the it's her face after Susan falls into the water. That and that makes the whole scene. I mean, that makes the entire crew that night when it was 3 a.m. or whatever, and everybody just and it's the 14th hour and everybody just wants to go home, stop and go over to her and say, "You are amazing." And that's 3 weeks into shooting, or 4 weeks in. This is beginning, because we're block shooting, I'm a madman, so we're like shooting the entire thing all out of order. And this is like the seventh episode we're shooting that day. And that's what Carly does at 4 a.m., or whatever it was at that night. That's amazing. That's amazing.
Let's keep the spotlight focused on Carly for a minute, because we actually have a clip that I'm very excited to share with
me
everybody.
Too.
Here we go.
This clip we're going to show you guys, I believe for the first time in public ever, and maybe the last. This is Carly's audition tape for the role of Darlene, and I believe that you'll see her audition first, and then you will see the scene as it actually played in the show. And I'm excited to see this. So
we've never seen this.
This is acting.
I'm going to go.
Wow. Awesome.
Booked it.
Wow.
Crushed it.
So good.
Carly, yeah. Carly, hop in the time machine for us. What was that day like when you were doing the audition? What do you remember from it? What excited you about the part?
I think that was actually when I tested with the network and everybody. And I remember Portia was there that day too, and she went to the audition with her, with her hair slicked back, and I just remember they made her walk out and change her hair.
Monsters.
And was like, okay. But no, it was really, you know, I'm sure you guys know, like, auditioning is definitely
weird.
It's like its own art form, you know. So many people, you can get on set and do it, but being, you know, doing it on your own in a room with people can be weird. But I actually thrive more on doing it in a room with more people than just like one or two, because then it's like awkwardly intimate. But yeah, I mean, it was, you know, I think I knew what I was gonna do. And I think my mentality with auditions, if I can impart any sort of wisdom, is, you know, as you just know, I just know what I'm gonna do, I go in there and do it, and then whatever happens, happens. You know, so I felt, for me, like, I felt like I just knew who she was and was ready to do it, and I'm so glad that they responded the way that they did.
Grace, can I bring you into that same conversation? What was your audition experience like? But also, the character of Dom, I would imagine, pops off the page immediately almost as much as she does on screen. When you read the sides or you read the script, what appealed to you? And then how did you try to translate that relationship you immediately felt? How did you translate that in the room?
Well, I sort of go into every audition thinking I'm going to sort of try to give a little something that hopefully nobody else has brought. And there's obviously no way to know that, but that is something that I strive to do. But I hadn't seen the show at all. I had heard of it because Rami was a friend before we had worked on a movie together. But I hadn't seen it, so I didn't go in there sort of giving them what I thought they wanted to see, or any preconceived notion of the tone of the show or how she should be. And she was also, you know, a brand new character, so I don't know. I also, I ran into an actress at the audition who I really, really admire. I love her work, and I got so nervous. Because I went in there and I was so confident, and then I saw her and I was like, "Fuck, it's fucking over. Like, this is done." Like, she's so this Jersey person, and I think that weirdly lit a fire under me, and I said, "I'm gonna do better."
You never know.
Sam, the aspect of casting that fascinates me is that when you give someone sides, you're considering them for the role that you've written immediately ahead of them, what you've written for that season, for example. But one of the tricks is casting people who you believe can grow into almost anything, who you have to cast on both immediate talent and ability and also potential. How do you balance that in these casting sessions? What do you look for?
I mean, you know, the weird thing is that whenever I write a character and I'm also imagining what they're gonna do and how they're gonna behave and all of that, and then I see it. I see what I'm expecting, and then I just fucking hate it. Like, I'm just like, this is too obvious. And this, I mean, originally, by the way, Dom was older. She was like close to retirement. And every time I do a casting call, I always, and this drives my casting director nuts, but I always say, let's just open casting call. But you say, no, I want every age. And she's like, are you serious? That's just like gonna quadruple our work, but I don't care. Like, to me, it's just like, I want to be surprised. I want to come in here and I don't want to see what I expected in my head. And I don't know if that's like a normal thing or not, but the one thing I value the most in every audition, and all these guys, this is what I saw in them when they came in, was the unexpected, the surprise, the choice, the boldness. And that to me, I respect. And you know, that it's not just to be different, but that it's on it. There's an honesty behind it. That to me is what resonates more than anything.
But to put some specificity behind that as well, when you first met Portia and considered her for Angela, season one Angela, were you already thinking of the things that you wanted to have her do in season two? And you saw that ability and that?
I don't know. I mean, how do you know that? How do you predict that that's where they can go? And I did know.
My hair. Before you changed it.
The hair.
It was very comparable to my hairstyle right there.
No, the answer is no. But what I did know was that she was fearless. I mean, she came in and she didn't give a shit. Carly, same way. I mean, all these guys, like, they just came in, did their thing. You learn a lot in the interview process, you know, in the beginning. If you're auditioning for someone that is... that's really good at what, you know, trying to consider you for the part, they're going to talk to you a little bit about it. That's an important part. Because to a large extent with acting, it's like, yes, you can pick a person that will transform into this other character, but at the very essence, there's going to be a little bit of you always in that role. And that there's a lot of insight. And so when I sat down with you, so it's a lot about who they were and then how they transformed when the audition started. And so it wasn't that I knew that Portia was going to be able to do this amazing arc. It was that I knew that she was going to make interesting choices and that maybe she would change it in unexpected ways that would surprise me and excite me. And that was more important than anything else.
One final question just about the casting process. Christian, when you got the script, what made you most excited? What made you most want to do this part? And when you make decisions like that, is it more the part that you are yourself hoping to get, or is it, do you have to factor in the other characters and the way they're written, the script overall, your conversations with Sam? What made you want this, basically?
I think it was that I had so many questions when I got to the end of the pilot. I was like, you know, I read that first script and I was like, what the hell did I just read? Yeah, and who is this character? And
your curiosity level was up down there.
It was up there, yeah, exactly. That was my curiosity level, exactly. So yeah, no, I ran to the meeting and, you know, had all my questions and he had these fantastic answers and I just got more and more excited after that.
One of the other big developments, I think, in season two was that Mr. Robot had fewer misters, and there was a larger focus on the female characters of the show, which was very welcome, and we got a lot more screen time for these women up on the top of the stage here. To celebrate that, the network actually put together a promo just solely focusing on these guys and their performances. So this isn't so much an exclusive, this is a promo, but I think it's something worth promoting, so we are going to take a quick look at that.
All right.
Miss is Robot.
Ms. Robot, right?
Like, robot.
Yeah. Mrs. Robot.
Mrs. Robot.
Guys, I say this every time they hand me a microphone and let me talk to you guys, but the one thing, and especially in front of Sam, I hope that we can have more scenes between all of your characters. I still hold
me
out.
Too.
I want more Darlene Angela friendship backstory. That's something I want. I feel like, yeah. Do you actually lobby for any of that yourself, or have you learned it doesn't pay to...
All the time.
to lobby for more scenes together.
Oh, yeah, we're all like, oh, can you just do more scenes of this and this and this and this and this? That's what we do.
And you get the same... Do you want to perform your response? This is an acting forum. Do you want to...
I would never dare to do that in front of all these talented...
That's the right answer.
I should just smile and nod.
Guys, obviously, we're going to cut to some audience questions in a moment, but I did want to ask, obviously, from a headline perspective, the biggest surprise in many ways of season two was the prison reveal. However, I do want to ask each of you, because you were so intimately involved in the making of the show, what surprised you the most in season two? And you can't say the prison, and it could be something, it could be a plot point, or it could just be a choice that your character made, or a moment, or perhaps it could be the appearance of Alf. I don't mean to feed you answers, but it could be.
So that was it. I mean, what are you going to say?
It might be. And I believe we have
guess.
Alf here tonight. Should we bring him out?
Hey, Alf!
You guys, Alf's not union, I don't think. We start with Rami.
Oh, shit.
I would say... I would say how universal, I mean, I thought this character that I was playing was very unique, and then I started seeing all of, you know, and this was more so watching than reading it, because it really came to fruition for me, having seen all of the episodes, but just how alienated every character in this story was from... you know, all these different perspectives of what we're all seeking in life, and how I was like, this character of Elliot is so unique and stifled but progressive in a way, and you could attribute some of the same words that you would use to describe Elliot to each and every one of these characters and performances. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a huge credit to you for pointing that out in so many dynamic and elegant ways throughout season two, and to the cast for really taking that, you know, upon each and every one of yourselves to make it so unique and make it so poignant that almost that you'd want to watch a show from any one of their perspectives. Mm-hmm. And that's what I found so intriguing and surprising, and it was quite magical.
I will say, I mean, we take risks, and at least I feel this way. If I take a risk, like, his ass is on the line because he's watching me. And so at the end of the day, not really that your ass is on the line, but no, just that we get to take risks, and at the end of the day, I can come to Sam and say, okay, did this work? Did this not work? And I trust his opinion. But what I really respect about Sam is that he takes a lot of risks. And I remember in so many panels, I'm going to misquote you, but basically what you presume, he'll do the opposite. And what I really liked about the second season is I felt that it was a complete departure from what we had seen in the first season. And not only the character development, but I don't know. I remember sitting at those table reads and I actually felt that there was such a difference. So that was a really cool surprise, which is even more inspiring when, I don't know, you're scared to take your own risks. Yeah.
I think I surprised myself every day that I was at work on what I thought was right or what was the, you know, the real good choice. And yeah, I just feel like I every day was turned upside down, and putting that much trust in Sam is a lot. And I think that seeing the end result, I was again surprised, because the thing that I thought worked for scenes of mine and scenes that I watched on set with everybody else were maybe not the right choices. And so I think that also Sam has such a clear vision and such a, he won't stray from the main thing. And that's, I think that's a real tribute to him and everybody else in the show.
I think my thing was much more to a specific part of the storyline. I just wanted to know what the heck happened to Tyrell. That was what surprised me the most, because we actually didn't know whether or not or where or how or when or how the whole, any adjective, put it on there. We didn't know shit.
By design, I guess.
I loved Craig Robinson and Joey Badass, just to throw that out there. I mean, come on, I was surprised.
I did too.
I certainly hadn't seen Craig Robinson in that particular light, and the fact that he was cast in that role, and
because I saw him, you guys worked together on...
We did Spam-a-lot together.
The Hollywood Bowl.
That's right.
What about that scene where Joey comes just like a ninja?
Oh, yeah.
Scene.
No, that was in a gruesome scene.
Yeah,
that was a gruesome scene to do and to watch. And a couple
moments.
I was
surprised when Sam told me I got kidnapped when I was younger.
Oh yeah.
Really surprised me.
That was shocking.
I was surprised when you were like, "I suck in that scene," and I'm like, "What are you talking about? That's a great scene." And
I then, did think I sucked,
but you, she was amazing.
Let's get to some of these audience questions. Thanks for being patient with that.
Right.
Here is a question for Rami. Rami, were you already an IT geek when you started doing this show?
IT geek?
Yes.
You couldn't even type.
The look on your face suggests no. Did you have to learn the lingo of the geek?
Yes, absolutely. I had no idea of.
I, on the other hand, was a master.
Oh, yeah. We were straight up tourists to this world.
That's it. Yeah, we were tourists.
We had no idea where to go or what to do or what to say. The language, it was not our first, second, or third language by any means. And, you know, I never approached it from that perspective, really. I did worry about that. Essentially getting in, to that aspect of him. But the thing I was more concerned with was just who he was at his core and dealing with the mental aspects. Getting further into that story, the story with, of course, the family and my father and this... these universal things that we toil with daily is loneliness and grief and everything that we've kind of dug deep down underneath, and I figured those were the most important things, and this idea of solitude and trying to get in touch with your friends in a way that there were so many obstacles keeping you from doing so and certain anxieties and some kind of hope for the way you saw the world. That was way more important to me than typing class. but you have to get into all of that essentially to round out the character. So I've learned a little.
Christian, here's a question for you, and I like it. It's short and to the point. What's your favorite scene? And why? And I would imagine your favorite scene that you've done so far in the show. What was your favorite one?
Shit.
Of the ones you remember in this moment with the spotlight on you.
No, but that is the toughest question.
Yeah.
Favorite scene. Of yours, or can you help me?
From season two or from both seasons?
Well, I was curious in both seasons, but I wonder season two, because going back to what we talked about,
play the scene in Times Square, then, if we're doing...
Oh, yeah.
Come on.
I was almost going to do a 3-2-1 countdown.
Oh, we should have done it. Yeah.
Tender.
But that was a great, yeah. First of all, I was happy to come back at episode 10. I was thrilled. And then to have that speech in Times Square was thrilling.
Not a very tender scene,
No, there was some
abuse.
Yeah, there was some abuse.
My favorite of their stuff this season that I almost started sobbing was when you guys were...
Oh, in the basement?
Do you know what I'm talking about? Yeah, that one.
The what?
When Elliot was crying and Mr. Robot like hugged him after all the beatings happened.
So after the sitcom,
yeah.
Right? And then when he
that was my favorite
thanked scene. Me.
Yeah,
that
my
was
favorite
great.
Scenes are on the cutting room floor.
Yeah. Oh man.
Dark. Dark. Just kidding. That was a joke.
Yeah. Whoa.
I loved Portia's singing scene at the bar.
I love that.
Oh, it was great. And yeah. Oh, God.
Love that.
That was
very brave.
And an excellent segue into this other audience member question.
Those are really cool. Sorry to cut you off. But when he intercuts and flashes back and he does stylistic choices like that, where you put one scene on top of the other. And, we never would see that in the script, but that's an editing choice that...
That's what made that scene work and function, definitely, was nice the dichotomy of those two moments and them relating to each other.
The question here is general. It's do you listen to music to put you in a mood for a certain scene? But I did want to direct that to Portia because for two reasons. One, you sang this season. And two, you had that earpiece in an awful lot. And obviously it was mostly spoken word mantras, but do you use music to prepare?
She listens to music
all the time.
She's always singing, too.
What do you mean?
I have a two-minute video of you doing Rihanna work.
Everyone has headphones on all the time.
Two-minute video. I will release it.
You do it a little bit wrong.
Oh, I know what you're talking about.
You. All of you do it.
And the question is also, what
music?
What is the count?
I don't know. I mean, Lemonade was pretty epic. I use Lemonade... in the bar scene, actually, made me feel drunk and crazy. I ain't sorry. We did that the entire season. No, I don't know. I think music is an incredible tool. I think it immediately immerses me into a different world. It's a trick. It's real. I feel like we all have this experience with art. I also use pictures. I love pictures to depict certain scenes to make my physicality different.
Portia, you were singing a couple of duets with Craig as well.
Yes, we were singing duets.
Which one? It was, yeah. No. I have all of this on Snapchat. I think it wasn't Raining Men.
He is actually a musician.
Yeah.
And he performs, which I didn't
There's
know.
Video footage, people. I got it.
Sam, the music, especially I think in season two, the music choices that you made were really spectacular and always surprising. Are those decisions made in post, or do you build a sort of a soundtrack for the emotional feeling of the season as you go?
There's definitely a playlist that I always make at the beginning of every season. And a lot of some of the songs are written into the script, and then they change in post, or they stay the same. It's kind of a fluid thing. Because music, to me, like I totally agree with Portia. I mean, music above any other art, and I'm including TV and movies in this, is it just evokes an emotion and tone. It's like a syringe. It's like an injection, and it's immediate. It's instant, and it's just and if you want to put yourself in that mood, in that tone. And that's why I use music a lot in the show. And these guys sometimes will read that. I remember you were listening to some of the songs that were written into the script. And for example, the scene, the fantasy future fairy tale scene, where I played the lullaby version of the basket case by Green Day. So when Rami was laying down, going into that dream sequence, we played that song in his earpiece. You know,
blonde wig one when I was.
Oh yeah, or when Carly was doing the heist, I played that Suffers song for her.
So I had it in my head for.
Yeah, I think we're all sort of into music.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The shootout scene at the cafe with Darlene and Cisco originally was written with that Future song, Shit. Do you remember?
Yeah, yeah.
So that whole, it was almost like the whole season. So
sometimes
I was
it backfires.
Listening to that.
Well, it's crazy because, like, you know, we all know you can play a scene and depending on what song you put to it, it has a completely different meaning and vibe and everything. So I think it's so cool the way that you use music.
Opening up the season with the Lupe Fiasco song.
Which too. was originally a Paul Simon song that I scripted.
That I listened to about 1,000 times.
Yeah, he listened to it 1,000 times.
Before he's like, that's not in there anymore.
Yeah, I'm like, it just didn't work.
I think we have time for, we'll take two more of these questions and then we have the fun treat to watch all together before we dismiss you all to dessert and one more drink. Rami, this is a question from Matt. How has the success of Mr. Robot impacted your life?
Wow. It's been tremendously impactful. You know, it's not often you get to play a character that, you know, has a voice like this. And you look at characters that are unique from an acting perspective. And, you know, growing up, it's like, I want to play that character that, you know, a lot of us, you know, I call the Joker in the deck, and it's one of those characters that you dream about. I remember growing up watching Johnny Depp do certain roles and going, man, if I could just get one of those, you know, one of those really special roles. And to have that in Elliot has been twofold, because it is, from an acting perspective, so dynamic and so special, but the things that he gets to say, just about the world we live in, and to speak so freely and uncensored and have this profound effect on the world is by far more than I could ever ask for from a role like this. I was just working in Serbia and Eastern Europe, and all these kids are coming out and they're fans of the show, and they're such fans of what this guy has to say about certain freedoms that you know, aren't necessarily, don't necessarily exist the way we would want them to exist, and the fight that he has inside of him and the world he'd like to see imagine is something that they could connect to on so many levels. And seeing that outside of an American perspective just gave new meaning to the voice of this character and what I really had, and the duty I had to make sure that I was doing right by this character, but so many people who believed in this character as well.
I think, I would clap. I think this question from Robbie is a nice one to end on, especially leading into the clip we're going to show. And I'm asking it not only because he said thank you with an exclamation point smiley face, which I appreciate. The question was, what is the funniest prank that any one of the actors played on another on set of Mr. Robot?
Oh, this got to be between Rami and Carly. Yeah. The gummy bears.
The gummy bear one.
Yeah. Oh.
Prank. That was just a nice thing.
So the gummy bear incident. Do you
when
want to
Rami covered my trailer in gummy bears.
Can I tell you a prank that we were gonna do?
Yes.
I'm just gonna give this away.
Yeah.
Because even if I do it to him, he won't even remember that I said this right now. Yeah.
Yeah.
What me and Carly wanted to do is Rami, on a particular day, where he had a particularly a huge day. We wanted to change his sides in the morning
to completely different scenes. That he'd be like,
because when you get up, you get those little sides. And I've had moments like that where I checked the night before and I checked and I've been working all week, and there might be one scene the next day that I didn't expect, and it's literally the worst heart attack. Sorry that
we
wanted
to make him feel.
So we wanted to make him feel that way.
What a warm
to add more stress into his work days.
I don't bring my sides to set or read them in the chair anyway, so it wouldn't have made a difference.
We would have.
Oh.
I come prepared.
Swish. He's such a badass.
Someone had to do it.
Okay.
Now that everyone is primed to laugh, to have a good moment, it seems the perfect opportunity to ask Sam to tell us one thing about season 3.
Was not expecting that.
See? You guys love twists.
Standing
I had
by.
One too. We're not really asking for spoilers. Can you give us an adjective to describe what people might expect in 2017 when they see season 3 of Mr. Robot?
Disintegration.
Ooh.
My gambit worked. All right, so obviously you can see these guys like to have a lot of fun together. I'm excited to see this. This is never before seen. The full length Mr. Robot blooper reel.
Oh, we should cool. Tell the story. This was the best prank. Can I? Oh, no, that was.
I think we got to end it. Thank you. I want to thank everybody up here on the panel for joining us tonight, all the cast, Sam. I want to thank everybody here for coming out tonight. Please join us for some dessert, another drink, and hopefully see you at another event sometime soon.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.